我先用中文来介绍一下这个萨米尔明教授，我们非常欢迎他。首先，我们用热烈的掌声欢迎他一下。为什么我要？阿明教授出生在1931年，大家可以算一下，今年他有多大了？刚才他一步就跨上来了。我所理解的，他的一生。 就是他是一位非常了不起的、杰出的一位马克思主义的经济学家，也是一位关于全球化的这个进程、这个资本主义历史的一个思考者。那同时呢，他同时我觉得他也是一位战士，这个是跟一般的我们通，他是一位伟大的学者，但是同时他也是一位战士，而且尤其我要提到的，他也是一位第三世界的。 重要的杰出的知识分子，就他的一生，可以这么说，除了在理论工作当中，在我们的学术工作当中，这个我们会读他的书。但如果大家去拉丁美洲、去非洲、在亚洲，他都是一位长期的活跃的，这个怎么说，一位斗士，一个真正的知识分子。我现在简要的介绍一下他的这个状况。 我们都知道他是一个，他是在这个1931年出生的，他是一位埃及人，他是出生在埃及的。我们今天说他是一位埃及的，出生在埃及的第三世界的国际主义的知识分子，也许是用这样来说。但他过去的接受的教育是在巴黎大学接受的教育，所以他的早期有大量的著作。 是法文的著作，当然有很多的著作是英文的著作。如果我记得有几十本、50多本、多少本，我已经记不住这个数量。他出版了大量的这个学术著作。那么他是在1957年从巴黎大学毕业的，获得的是经济哲学博士学位，所以大家可以知道他的这个背景。所以他是一个，1957年到1960年。 他担任埃及经济发展组织的高级经济学家，以后呢，他在国外工作。那也都知道，1957年和1960年，这个是一个非常特殊的时期。那么这是什么样一个时期呢？这也是万隆会议之后的时期。阿明教授呢，也是万隆会议的参与者。现在大概直接参与万隆会议的筹备组织工作的。 在世的人已经不多了。我上一次见到的是这个前南斯拉夫的外交部长，他也是一位多次，大概有90，好像比阿明教授年纪还要略微大一点，是这样。所以过去，这个前些年，阿明教授曾经写过一篇很重要的文章来回忆这个万隆会议的组织的过程。所以他是直接参与，那个时候他就来中国，所以。 不要说在座的年轻人，就是我还没有到这个世界上，所以他已经在参与到这样的这个工作了。那么1963年起，先后担任过法国普瓦迪埃大学、巴黎大学、塞内加尔达卡尔大学的教授，还有就设在达卡的联合国非洲经济开发与计划研究所的这个，他是所长，他是这个负责人。那1980年起呢，担任联合国。 未来非洲战略局的负责人，所以我们一般会把他看作是一位新马克思主义的理论家，著名的全球化问题的专家，国际政治经济学家等等等等。我想他对中国的关注是从50年代就已经开始了。他有一篇文章也专门讲到他和毛泽东思想的相遇，这样一个历史，就是他的。 我个人的理解，因为我们都知道他的这个理论，我们通常把它曾经当时影响最大的这个理论，我们把它叫做依附理论（ （dependency theory）， 还有这个 delinking， 他关于这个脱钩的这个理论。我个人的一个理解就是，他是基于第三世界的广泛的经验，也是对这个资本主义。 殖民主义和帝国主义的历史，尤其是从第三世界的这个视角来思考这个问题，产生出的一个国际政治经济的分析。 那这个分析在一定程度上也呼应了五十年代独立自主自力更生发展中国家如何发展自己的这个经济的这样的一个经验的一个历史过程。所以他的这个整个的这个思考是伴随着这个从二十世纪他自己已经从五十年代开始一直持续的来追踪当代世界的这个变化。那么他的这个同时呢，我刚才也说他是很多社会运动的组织者。我们在座的今天有我们邀请了香港岭南大学的刘建之老师，他来做我们这个评论人。那刘建之老师就是一个这个我们中文叫什么 ？Arena 的中文叫什么？
亚洲交流中心。
亚洲
交流中心。
交流中心，这是一个第三世界的社会组织和社会运动的组织。那刘建之教授现在是这个组织的负责人。像类似于这样的活动，在全球各地，在当然世界社会论坛等等这些方面。这个可以这么说，这个阿民教授的很多的思想对于这些社会运动产生了巨大的这个影响。那么他的这个思想和他的理论，我觉得首先是非常早的就被翻译介绍到中国，实际上由他的很多书也翻译介绍到中国。那就我个人的这种经验来说，恰恰是在90年代1989年的大转变之后，也就是说，这个全球化的浪潮，尤其是新自由主义全球化的这个浪潮到来的时候，阿民教授的思想被重新，在中国被重新介绍、翻译和关注，是和这样的一个思潮有关的。也就是说，他从来不是站在那个主流的潮流里面的，恰恰相反，是在这个潮流的进程中。他的一个带着一个批判性的思考介入到当代中国思想的这个讨论里面。我觉得我自己也有幸嘛，我90年代我就大概94还95年我也写过一篇介绍这个阿民教授的这个他的思想，关于全球化和全球性的这个垄断的这个主要的这个思想的一个讨论，当时在读书杂志上我还有这印象。当年在90年代中期发表关于阿民教授的文章的时候，是当时的我想是极其罕见的这不同的思想。现在能够接受他的思想和讨论的应该很多了，但90年代这样的思想是非常非常罕见的，在这是一个大潮。所以我们邀请今天也不是第一次请这个阿民教授来清华大学演讲，我们过去也邀请过阿民教授来演讲，今天是又一次我们邀请他来演讲，我们非常高兴。因为这么多年来他所不管在这个顺利的这个绝大部分时候是不那么顺利的各种各样的这个困境当中，他来思考这个当代世界的命运，尤其是关注这些第三世界国家的这个命运。所以他的这些思想经过很多年的这个检验之后，有相当多的思想越来越被很多人所了解和接受。所以我昨天从外地回来，下了飞机打开手机的时候，第一个冒出来的是这个朋友圈里头关于阿民教授在北大的这个马克思主义论坛上的这个讲话的摘要。我们可以看到他87岁，可是极其锐利，完全的不失锋芒，极其富于战斗性。我觉得非常的我觉得这个是对我们来讲，有这样的一个机会来倾听，这样的一位这个老的学者、老的战士和杰出的理论家来做这样一个报告，我是非常高兴的。所以我们今天呢，先请他讲大概差不多一个小时的样子，然后我们邀请这个刘建之教授。和穆维仁教授，这个 Viren Murthy 是我要介绍的另外一位，他是印度裔在美国的这个美国学者，他是威斯康星大学的副教授，也是今年在我们清华大学在我们高等研究所担任这个访问学者的这么一位研究中国思想和亚洲思想的一位非常有 独特见解的一位学者，我们一会儿让他会做出这个评论。所以我们现在就用热烈的掌声欢迎Samir Amin教授给我们做讲演。
And I'm very happy and thankful first to my old friend who invited me here, but to all of you for having come to listen to me. Now, I think I would summarize, this is a very good summary, in one line: Marx and living Marxism, not Marxism, living Marxism, are more relevant today than ever, than it was even at the time of Marx's writings. For me, to be a Marxist is not to be a Marxologist, that is to start from Marx, even if Marx was really a genius and the start was the best one possible. But it was the start. And we ought to continue, to deepen, to analyze the changes in the world in the light of how he started it. Second, Marx was not an academic. And there is academic Marxism, possibly, but Marx wanted to change the world. But he was aware that you cannot change the world unless you understand it first. But understanding it, you learn from action to change it. The action is the only way to get Marxism developing. This is why we ought to distinguish Marx from Marxisms. And I would put plural, because, and that is normal, the not only individuals or thinkers or academics who studied Marx, but the Marxist ideas which penetrated important political and social forces that contributed, for better or worse, here and there, with successes and failures, to change the world. What is most important is to understand why they understood Marx in the way they understood it in their time and in their place. Not to put Marx to them, like a professor at university marking the student. This is good, this is bad, this is true Marxism, and this is irrelevant, or this is revisionism, and so on, which is polemical, but does not give its consideration to why the Social Democrats of the Second International understood Marx in a certain way, why Lenin understood it differently, why Mao understood it differently, etc. And why also communists here and there throughout the world understood Marxism. Not to put a mark to them, good or bad, but to understand why, what were the circumstances. Today, I want to come to some conclusions which will be the most important part of my introduction, of my speech. Two conclusions. One, what are in my opinion, the major and real challenges which the Chinese people and society, and therefore also state, are facing today. Today, not even 10 years before, today, and for the coming visible future. What are they? It's most important in order to try to be lucid and to try to have an effective strategy to face those challenges. And second, What are the challenges also, or the main challenges, which the people of the world, the working people, the vast majority in the south and in the north, are facing today, and why we need to revive internationalism and organize it, not only at a humanistic, general, moral, I am an internationalist, I love other people, and so on, but organize it. That is, we need the building of a new international, and let's call it communist or not communist, an international of working classes and peoples, which is a concept a little wider than the working classes stricto sensu. Now, but in order to be convincing, I hope, I should make a long detour before coming to presenting to you what are those challenges. So that they don't appear to you as coming from the blues or from the particular ideas of Samir Amin without any argument or proof that it is worthwhile being considered and discussed. I'm not sure that I'm right, but I would give my arguments so that you can accept them or reject them with arguments also, not just with positions. Now, in order to do that, I think we have to look into what is essential in the capitalist, not mode of production, in the capitalist society throughout its short history, relatively to other the history of other societies, such as yours or mine, the Egyptian. We are not new nations, we are nations since 5,000-6,000 years. But in order to understand that, we ought to make, to clarify some fundamental concepts and fundamental conclusions or deriving from those concepts about that reality. I think, personally, I have been a reader always, all my life. I have read all Marx and with attention 4 times in my life. I discovered that was every 20 years, from the age of 20 to the age of 80. And it happens to have coincided with important changes in the world order. And therefore, I think, right or wrong, that what I'm deriving from those readings is Marxism. It's not the exclusive way of understanding Marx, but it is Marxism. I would not say that understanding it in another way would be a wrong way, but a different one, and for which reasons? Now, first point one, we ought to distinguish what I call crisis within capitalism from the crisis of capitalism. These are two things different. The crisis within capitalism, there has been continuously and many crises of a variety of nature, economic cyclical crisis, political, social, coming out of class struggle and history crisis, which have been led to capitalists being able to move ahead, to give an answer to those crises. But the crisis of capitalism has a historical mode, historical period, which is coming to its end, and which we should look at, and I dare say, capitalism, we have entered in the age of senile capitalism. a society, an organization of society, which cannot anymore produce anything progressive. You know, the capital accumulation is based on exponential growth. Exponential growth is the pattern of the growth of cancer, which means it leads by itself necessarily to death. Therefore, that pattern, which is inherent, which defines capitalism, cannot be continued. We have to find another type of development, if we call it so, of society. Not only for the South, but for the whole world. Perhaps the ecologists have, I would say, rediscovered that, because in my reading, it was already announced by Marx. He understood it. It's a good thing that people who have never read Marx rediscover it 150 years later by themselves, which means that rationality leads you to same conclusions, and this is a good thing. But it was already there. And this is why, and this is my reading of Marx, Marx considered capitalism as a short bracket in human history. A short bracket of a few centuries, 1, 2, 3 centuries. We are Chinese or Egyptian. We do consider that 1, 2, or 3 centuries in our history is a short period. We are not North American, who consider that 10 years is a long period. a bracket. Why? Why? And that is very important. Marx discovered, and this is our starting point, the fundamental contradiction of that system, which makes it non-viable in, say, the long run. Beyond class struggle, which is a platitude for anybody who has a minimal realism when he or she looks at reality, social reality, throughout history. Beyond that, in Book 2 of Capital, Marx divides the production, the capitalist production, he doesn't look at other patterns of production, into the famous two departments, production of means of production and production of consumer goods, and how they are related. And he look into, and he put figures to continue his development, how reproduction of that system, enlarged reproduction, that is, reproduction of that system with a growth of, say, 3% per year, from one year to another, etc., could function. What are the conditions for, and those conditions are very rigorously related to, one, the division of labor, second, the productivity of social labor for the production of any good, equipment, or consumption. And he derives them, the those conditions. But that could lead the superficial reader to think that, okay, capitalism has its own rationality, but it functions, and it can therefore function, let's say, forever, or at least for a very long historical period, and give legitimacy to that system. That is what conventional, what Marx called vulgar economics, says, but is unable to prove, that the system, a generalized market, market of all production would be commodities. All natural resources would be turned into commodities, including land, perhaps even atmosphere, etc. And labor is also a commodity. That this system of generalized market lead naturally by itself, by its own working, tend to an equilibrium. There can be disequilibria, but they can be overcome by and within the logic of the system. All of them, before Marx, Bastiat and others, after Marx, and even the most brilliant, clever people like Walras or like Sraffa or like Keynes have failed to prove it. Now, the Nobel Prizes are usually given to people who have all failed to prove anything, but they are given precisely for that reason. They pretend to have reached the goal, and the academic consider that they have reached the goal, and the next day they are forgotten precisely, while Marx is not forgotten. Who said the other? He analyzed, therefore, the system as a system moving from one disequilibrium to another one without tending to any equilibrium. Now, in book two, Marx shows, that the fundamental contradiction is that the conditions for reproduction are in conflict with the fundamental rule of capitalism as a social system, that is, having the lowest possible wage payment for labor force, and therefore that there is a tendency of profits to be always too large, the opposite exactly of what the conventional economists say to their governments. Wages are always too high and profits are always too low. It's the opposite. Profits are always too large and wages are always too low, which would make the system unable to operate. This is why it's a short bracket. It has been, at the time of when Marx was writing, particularly the Communist Manifesto, 1848, his age was 30 years old, and capitalism, in fact, existed as a dominant mode of production in a very small part of the world. England, not even Great Britain. England, northeast France, a quarter of France, Belgium, and a very small part of Western Prussian Westphalia. That's all. Elsewhere, even in Europe, it was not yet the dominant. And yet, in spite of that, Marx discovered what is the future of that system. That is, one, that it will conquer the world. Not only the whole of Europe, but the world, very fast, in a number of decades. And that it will not be able to go beyond that. At that point in time, when it has conquered the world, then it enters into senility. It has to be replaced by something more advanced. Now, therefore, Marx was very optimistic. This is what happened within a few decades. The whole of Europe at various degrees, of course, became capitalist, plus North America, a little later Japan. Colonies did exist before from the mercantilist period, but were generalized or semi-colonial, like your country, through wars. The Opium War was the first one, never forget it, in China. The good friends of the West have started in that way to integrate China in the modern world. So I'm not, it's a very, a series of very important problems, but this is not my problem, to look into what were the challenges, the crises, and how they were overcome in order to achieve this target of this of the logic of capitalism. But to come precisely at the point when it became senile. That is, reached a point where the income distribution, the distortion in the income distribution, could not anymore be compensated by further expansion of capitalism. I think that Rosa Luxemburg, before many other Marxists, understood that in the early 20th century, 1900, around 1900, before First World War. And therefore, that the system was facing with a starting crisis of capitalism. Now, we have had two, we can give them a name, long crisis, because it covers decades and not years, systemic crisis, because it's a crisis of the system. We can call it as you want, but I would call them a crisis of the system. Two long crises. One started at the end of the 19th century, and the second one started, and we can put a date, 1973. I will say later why. And it is the one in which we are living. Now, capital reacted to capital as a the owners of capital, the capitalists, and the capitalist class, represented by their political power, the power of their governments, their states, how they reacted to that crisis, long crisis of capitalism. By three sets of measures. One, moving towards monopoly, giving transforming capitalism into a system of monopolies. You can call them oligopolies, if you like. And deepening the power, the economic and political and cultural power of monopoly, of monopolies. Second, deepening the globalization. Globalization is nothing new. And I would even say that globalization existed even before capitalism in other forms. The Silk Road, for instance, not the new project of Silk Roads, but the, those which existed earlier are proof of that. The expansion of religions, moving thousands of kilometers from one place to another, is a proof of that. Modern globalization started with as a response to that, which means modern deepening the polarization between the dominant imperialist powers and the dominated societies, whether independent or not, whether more or less advanced in capitalism or not. And third, the running ahead into financialization. I will come to that concept later. That is in creating an outlet for excess of profits, which cannot be invested in the expansion of the productive system. That is, say, to use common words, organizing waste. Good and bad, because education is waste from that point of view, but it's good waste. And health is waste, but it's good waste. But selling costs, which is to give a name to a mark, a trademark, and saying this is the best one and you have to pay for it, it's a real waste. And there are many other patterns of that. That was discovered early or late, as you want, 1960 exactly, by Baran and Sweezy, that we, for the analyzing capitalism today, let's say, as of his capitalism moving into the phase, senile capitalism, into the phase of decadence, final crisis, say. Now, with two departments, you have to invent a third department, department three, absorbing the surplus in a variety of forms, useful socially and very harmful or useless socially. Three departments instead of two. Otherwise, you cannot understand capitalism today. I think that among the academics, it is only a small minority of those who claim, and they have the right to claim that, to be Marxist, who considers that introducing the third department is absolutely necessary to understand modern world. But funny enough, if academics did not understand that, Lenin and Mao understood it. And it's important because there were not two academics. They led gigantic movements who came even to power, and in not small countries. So that is important in order to understand what is the... Now, senile capitalism doesn't mean that, like old person, they will die someday by themselves as a result of some circumstances or any sickness, but easily they will disappear by themselves. No, a senile system becomes ferocious because it wants to survive at any price, which means that we have entered into a period not of peace, democracy, end of history, rationality, etc., but exactly the opposite, a period of wars, possibly, and I would hope, revolutions or revolutionary advances, counter-revolutions, violence, etc. Now, how the first long crisis of capitalism was, what was the response of the peoples across the planet to that first? Well, a number of what I'm calling insignificant events for the conventional economist. First World War, the Russian Revolution, the crisis of 29, Nazism, Imperial Japan, the Popular Front in France and Spain, the New Deal in the US, the Second World War, the victory of the Red Army over the Nazis, the Chinese Revolution, Bandung, and the reconquest of their independence by the people of Asia and Africa. Well, this was the response. It was not it was not Keynes. This is blah blah to say it was Keynes. Keynes was a small part of that. very small. It was gigantic historical changes, good or bad. From our point of view, probably the revolution, social, in the name of socialism, the Popular Front are good response. Nazism or fascism or Imperial Japan are not the good response to it, but both existed. Both existed. So there is no reason why we do the response to that will be not also, and it has started to be so, a number of events which transform the world, whether we like it or not. Now, from there, I go to, now, how, what are the, oh yes, thank you, what are the characteristics of this second long crisis, and how, what are the main, major characteristics of the response of monopoly capital to that long crisis. I am submitting him here three characteristics which are partly new, or revival in a new form of what was done as responses to the first long crisis. One, reinforcing the power of monopoly capital, because monopoly capital was already there as a response to the first one, but reinforcing. And that led to a qualitative change in the degree of control, and I'm saying of control, not of property, of monopoly capital over the whole economic system. That is, all economic activities have been turned, I'm perhaps exaggerating as usual, I'm saying that often, but almost all, or more and more, into subcontracting for monopoly capital. Small enterprises, farmers, everybody. They remain formally independent, but they are de facto submitted as subcontractors, whether they like it or not, controlled upstream and downstream by monopoly capital. The case of farmers in capitalist countries is typical. They are totally controlled upstream by those who provide the credit, inputs and so on. They are all gigantic monopolies, and downstream by those who control the commercialization of their product. To the extent that the system of price, contrary to the saying of market economy that they are the true price of the market, they are artificial prices dictated by the dictatorship of monopoly capital, which reduce their income to zero, in the case of Europe, for instance, to the extent that they are compelled, the governments are compelled to give subsidies to compensate them, and which means that the taxpayer, that the whole population, is paying a rent to monopoly through the false system of prices, reducing the income of farmers to zero or close to it. Now, that is one. It's a new stage. Now, here again, I have written on that. Other people, very important in my opinion, most of them claiming to be Marxists, some not even, just observers of so-called reality, have given the proof of that in detail with figures. So I felt myself comfortable in saying that it's a new stage of monopoly capital. Now there have been debate among some, a good number of Marxist academics, particularly in the Western countries of West Europe, France, Britain, Germany, and United States and Italy, over how to qualify that variety of name that is semantic of little importance. Now, the second was to deepen globalization, not to invent globalization, because globalization was always there, but to deepen it. It is the so-called neoliberalization. I, looking at what is the recipe for that globalization, the so-called conditionality that IMF, World Bank, and the European Union, the United establishment of the United States and Japan suggest as the recipe for everybody, is rather, I would call it, paleo-liberalism. That is, liberalism as it was understood by the early capitalist class in England in 1820. 1820, not 1920. That is, that the worker has no rights. There is nothing of that kind. And they do freely what they want. It's free market. So, deepening it, paleo-liberalism. And third, financialization. Again, this department three is the one which is growing. And it is growing exclusively, it's the exclusive department which is growing in the Western capitalist advanced countries, the triad, United States, Europe, and Japan, and which is growing even in the countries, and I would include China, where you have also a growth of department one and two, that is a growth of real production. You have the two. So it's less imbalanced, but nonetheless existing. The proportion of that department, three, to GDP, which was around 10% in 1913, before World War I, around 30% in the after World War II, that is, had moved along slowly, has been an enormous jump. That is, the curve is like that, exponential. During the past 70 years, and particularly growing faster during the last two, three, or four decades, which is the signal of senility, precisely. And that financialization now is the assessment, not mine. It's difficult to assess, to give exact figures, because it's a mixture of all kinds of things. And as I said, some are absolutely useful. I'm not for an austerity and reducing education and health. But that would be not waste, a good waste. I mean, at the expense of producing mobile telephones, long live better education and better health and less telephones, but also waste. And waste is not just what appears morally as the worst of waste, armaments, and destructive of mass destruction in particular, and so on. But all sorts. Now, that is not viable. Now, when I say that it is not viable, I'm immediately answered by bad people in the West and by good people in China. But the same argument. No, that is not what is happening. What is happening is a slow growth, very slow, in the old Western industrialized countries, in the triad, United States, Europe, and Japan, but compensated by a high growth in the South, unequal, and particularly in the socialist South, China. And therefore, what is happening is not a crisis of capitalism, it's a crisis of Western capitalism, if we could call it so. And the transfer of the center of gravity to other regions of the world, particularly Eastern Asia, China number one, but possibly also other countries like India, or possibly also other countries like Brazil and others. And I'm saying, I'm answering to that fact. But what is it exactly? What is happening as a result of that? That more ferocious hate and attempt of the old Western imperialist, traditional historical imperialist, to maintain their control over the whole planet by more and more violent ways. And one, they have done it. They are doing it every day. And they have done it with some success to this day. One, by abolishing in precisely the traditionally so-called democratic, bourgeois democratic countries of the West. Western Europe, United States, I don't know if Japan should be added to that, it's a little specific, but still. Into what I dare call a totalitarian system. It's no more democracy. It's a totalitarian system. Monopoly, centralized monopoly power is not only exclusively economic power and subcontracting for those who remain out of its reach, but also have captured the political system, captured the so-called electoral parties, right and left, and reduce them to be the servants of monopoly capital. They all have to admit the socialists, the previous social democrats, who were real social democrats in 1945, and who introduced a historical compromise to the benefit of the working classes, which I do not look at as something awful and revisionist, but as a limited but important progress who have changed the society to better, reducing them to accept so-called neoliberalism, that is paleoliberalism, becoming so-called social liberals. This is antinomous. You cannot be socialist and liberal together. Liberal means capitalist liberalism. Freedom, liberty for capital, not for the working classes. And that has delegitimized democracy. In the West, you can vote, and also in many countries, a masquerade. You have multi-party system or pseudo-multi-party system, and votes. In some cases, they are not fabricated votes, in others, they are. Free votes. But so, what is the result? The next day, the parliament meet and say, we cannot do anything. We have to obey to the demands of the market, which is the polite way to say monopoly capital. Angela Merkel said it in a very naive way. She says, you are free to vote, but you should understand that you cannot, your representative cannot run but within the limits, the boundaries of the rationality of the market. So why do you vote then? A humoristic friend of mine wrote as an economist, why do we have so many economists, professional economists, if they all say exactly the same thing? Name one, and you make economy by having no other economist paid. And he will say for the truth for everybody. So that is accompanied also by monopoly capital having captured so-called information or disinformation, the medias. The medias, which enjoyed a degree of variety in the past, are now repeating exactly the same thing every day, everywhere. It has been turned into a clergy in the service of the financial aristocracy. Now, it's also, they have captured so-called culture, that is, individuals being formatted to think that they are free individuals, while in fact they are being turned into consumers and spectators of the TV instead of being citizens working. So that's the new culture. Now, this is totalitarian. Maybe I should qualify it by saying that it looks soft totalitarian as compared to fascism, for instance, of the old pattern, because it does not require from the people that they demonstrate their support. No, that they keep quiet only and think that there is no alternative. So you have to adjust day by day to what is the real world. That's enough. It's soft totalitarian, but that soft totalitarian can become ferocious if need be, here and there, and go to criminalize the demonstrations and the struggles against the system because it could become dangerous. Now, another feature. So the system is already there at that point, which leads also as a consequence to the best possible and the worst possible. The best possible is that not only some intellectuals, but through their struggles, people become more and more lucid about the reality and able, therefore, to develop a strategy of action, of struggle, which would be moving ahead on the long road, moving out of capitalism. That is, the challenge is not finding a solution to the crisis within capitalism, but moving out of capitalism in crisis. This was a title of one of my book, Moving Out of the Crisis of Capitalism, or Moving Out of Capitalism in Crisis. That is the challenge. The other main feature, which is new, imperialism is nothing new, but imperialism has moved into a qualitative change. Imperialism was to be conjugated in the plural. There was nothing called imperialism, but there was the British imperialism, American imperialism, Japanese imperialism, French imperialism, etc. And often in conflict among themselves, including going to war. Now, I'm speaking of the collective imperialism of the triad, the historical major imperialist countries. Collective imperialism of United States, Europe, and Japan. One, what is the proof of that? The proof of that, there are so many proofs every day. You have NATO. They have organized themselves in one military alliance with a leadership, the US, and with what I call subordinate allies, not lackeys, allies, but subordinated. They can say, well, we don't like this, but finally they say, yes, sir, to the president of the United States, whoever he is. Now, why? Because precisely of that, they need more and more violence. They know more than we know, and more than most of the naive people in China think they know, that they cannot run the world, dominate the world, continue their domination, but associated and deeply associated, subordinate their minor conflicts to the common strategy against the rest of the world. We are a minority. We are only 85% of humankind, if you add Asia, including China, Africa, Latin America, the Caribbean. And we'll be more than 85%, 90% close in a few decades. But we are a minority. We are insignificant people. We ought to continue to be dominated. Now, everybody has to become conscious of that. And not to think that we can reach, catch up within that system, and that the imperialists, collective imperialists, will accept it. Perhaps because they are nice people, perhaps because they cannot do anything else, they will not accept it. So, when many of the Chinese people and others elsewhere, but I'm here in China and I want you to win, not to lose the battle, think that we had a high growth, it could continue within the global system, and we shall become the first economy in the world soon, and we can continue and so on. And after all, China had a long history, and we were one of the, or perhaps the most important area in the world long ago, will be again it, and that will be accepted. It is not accepted. You will be fought, including war, in order not to allow you to reach your goal. If you continue to be naive and do not take all the measures in order to prevent the catastrophe. So you have a big responsibility. So we are, I may come now, I'm close to 45 minutes, to the two conclusions. One, what is the challenge for you? I'm saying, starting, the triad will never accept a so-called prosperous, even capitalists, a fortiori, if you want to prevent something in the name of Chinese characteristics from socialism, will not accept it. And therefore, you see, you have an example. Yeltsin thought that getting rid of socialism, but getting rid of socialism officially and really, in the case after the breakdown of the Soviet Union, we accept capitalism as it is, And the model is the Western capitalist countries. And the model is United States. And the model is the capitalist globalization. We accept all unconditional surrender, unconditional submission to the rules of capitalism. And then we are going to be admitted as a European partner in European capitalism within the global capitalist system. What was the action of the West? Was immediately to destroy the Soviet Union and Russia, to try to, and to achieve the goal, to transform it into a subordinate provider of raw materials, a colony, and nothing else. So do take this lesson, historical lesson, into consideration. The strategy of the US vis-à-vis China is that one. It's not to accept, and I don't mean even, I don't go to say to support, but even to accept the success of China. And therefore, not be naive. To show that there are very real indications of the menace, I think we can take, it's not by pure chance that the United States establishment has chosen North Korea and Iran in the name of so-called denuclearization of the two countries to be the target of possible US NATO attacks on them. Military. One is the East bounded, close to China on the east, the other on the west. They have never, and they will continue to support the Dalai Lama and the so-called Tibetan independence of Tibet and independence and the most reactionary Islamic forces in Xinjiang. And they say it. Never forget that. They had even a plan to divide China proper, as they call it, into regions with different status in the global system. And there was a, there are documents for that. You ought to know them. And fortunately, those documents, even if they are called some of them secret, they are well known of the US establishment and signed or countersigned as approved as an ID by various presidents of the United States, including Clinton, not Trump, but Clinton, saying that we could envisage a war having and annihilating, that is killing, 600 million people in China. Well, half of China of today. So, what can you do facing such a challenge? One, you ought to be lucid and know it and not naive. But that's not enough. You have moved, China has moved as of 1979 or more the next decade, the 90s, into globalization. It has moved into trade globalization, that is, its exports and imports are growing, have grown and continue to grow, have grown very, very fast. And you are even aggressive in that area, in the export area. Okay. Second, you have moved into a pattern, into globalization of capital investment, real capital investment. That is, you invite and accept foreign capital to establish in China, and you have started exporting capital of China to buy assets elsewhere. But until now, you have put rules to manage that participating to the global investment globalization. That is, foreign companies cannot do anything in China. They have to be approved. They have to submit to rules, associate with private or public capital. There is a state interference, whether it is effective or not, whether so-called corruption limits its efficiency. These are, you should study that carefully. But this is your job. But China has not moved until today into financial globalization. That is, until today, the banking system remains a state-owned banks in China, or almost exclusively until today. That, along with the yuan being managed, that is, rate being of exchange being decided by the Central Bank of China, which means by the government of China, not by the so-called market. Now, so you are not participating. The result until now is very positive to in your favor. The result until now is China has, if you measure it in purchasing power, represent the GDP of China 18% of the global GDP. And if you measure it in current yuan or dollars, because the rate is fixed, 16%, very close. The difference is very close. India has moved into, was half before, in the time of the ruling previous governments of the Congress Party. With BGP, thanks to BGP, it has moved from 50% participating to the financial globalization to 100%. Now, the GDP of India measured in purchasing power represents almost exactly the half of that of China, that is 8%. But measured in current dollars, less than 2%. That is, participating to the financial globalization has given the possibility, the capacity of monopoly capital to practically transform India as a subcontractor. And and most of the benefit go to the Western global monopoly capital. So I'm saying, until now, you have a gun in your hand, not participating the Chinese. You have a gun in you. You are not a member, you are not participating to global financialization. Why should you give this gun to your enemy? Why? In the name of what? Because he's nice. The next day he will use it against you. So keep it. That is a very important point. It might turn to be a decisive point. The other one is that, and this is why I'm not, when I'm asking, is China capitalist or socialist? I say it's not the correct way of asking the question. China is surely not socialist, but I can hardly say it's capitalist, because capitalism is based on the private property of everything, including and particularly land. And until now, with many concessions, but until now, the property, agricultural, agrarian property, remains the property of the state, with managed by the village communities and with a target, even if it is not implemented really and completely, of having equal access of all rural families to it. Now, that is also has made you, is the basis of the historical wide alliance, social alliance, between the peasants, the urban workers, the middle classes, which was the great achievement of the Chinese Revolution and of Mao. This is the other gun that you have in your hand. If you suppress it and you allow land to be turned into a commodity, within a few decades, you will move from the situation of China to that of Brazil to compare. In China, China is a poor country. You have only 6% of the arable of the arable lands on of the planet. 6%. And you produce and you feed 22% of humankind correctly. I would not say beautifully, but correctly. Beautiful cuisine, of course, but that's another question. That is linked to this non-commodity property of land. Brazil have the rate, land of arable land to population is in the case of Brazil 17 times better than for China, not twice or three times better, 17 times better. But since Brazil, throughout all its history, has been a capitalist country, in modern history, and has admitted that land is a commodity, the result is that the rural population has been reduced to less than 10%, and you have 2/3 of the urban population who are living in slums. So that I would say, and I say it and wrote it, China is a poor country where you don't see immense poverty. Brazil is a rich country where you see exclusively immense poverty. Every day, everywhere. So, do you want to move from the situation of China of today to that of Brazil of today? That is the second challenge. Now, and I come to my last point and, about the challenges. The same challenge that is how to face senile capitalism is met by the people in the West, in the Triad, and in the South, in the other countries of the South. There are many movements and struggles against the results of that ruling of the system by monopoly capital of the triad. Those struggles have my sympathy, and I think they are perfectly legitimate, but they remain until today fragmented at local, national levels and at global level. Fragmented. And the result is that they cannot develop a strategy, an offensive strategy. They are on the defensive. That is, we have acquired in the past this right, you are attacking, reducing this right, we try to defend it. They are on the defensive. They leave the initiative in the hands of their enemy. We have to move from there to an offensive strategy. we have an alternative project. And we compel you to adjust to our alternative project instead of us adjusting to your project. Now, we won't reach that goal unless the gradually, and it will take time. This is why history is long. And this is why declines are long period in history, not short. move beyond fragmentation at the local level, at the national levels, because it remains the place where you may have another government. By elections, I doubt, but by struggles which change the balance of forces. And at the global level. Now, Marx understood that from the very beginning. And this is why Marx did not write only The Capital, but he participated as the main founder of the First International. Internationalism for him was not, it's humanism, of course, but not, was not just moral humanism, it was to be organized. And as lucid as possible of the common interests that is the First International. Then the working classes of Western Europe basically organized themselves in a Second International. Then with the October Revolution, Lenin understood and created a Third International, for the first time a Third International after Baku, which was not exclusively Western European, but included people of Asia and Africa and Latin America. And we need something. I will not go into how and what would be the characteristics, but we need also to think of creating an international, just like the social forums, a place of free debates. Okay, free debates are good per se, are useful, but they have their limits. More than that, we need in order to allow to make possible common strategies and therefore common victories, what I would call not pompously revolution with a capital R, but revolutionary advances which create the conditions for further or later possible also step ahead in the long road to socialism. You know, Mao was very patient. Mao never said that 1949 was a socialist revolution. And the name of China is the People's Republic of China. It's not the Socialist Republic. It's not the bourgeois republic like Sun Yat-sen dreamt, like the Kuomintang tried and failed. But it was the people's. It's different. But people's mean can become, move towards socialism, or can degenerate and move towards capitalism. The two are there. And he knew that. And you ought to pay attention to where we are, and that the road to communism for me, and for Marx before me, is not a utopian dream. No, it is a higher stage of human civilization. That is where the principle of solidarity replaces the principle of competition. The main principle on which our common on which capitalism is based is competition. Not only competition between companies, but competition between workers, between nations, call them as you want. In some cases, I hate the word, it would be competition according to so-called race races according to the color of their skin, but competition. Communism is a society based on the principle of solidarity. Solidarity between individuals, between partners in a nation, call it as you want, at the global level, between nations. Now, it's another higher level. That, and again, I go back to Mao. When Mao was asked, when will that be reached? Oh, he said, be patient, Chinese are, in 1,000 years. he was probably voluntarily exaggerating, which meant not tomorrow. But we ought to go in that direction and prepare it, prepare what the utopia of today to become the reality of tomorrow. Thank you.
那么我就写了大概十几页，所以他说我会快的进量快的讲。那么他说今天我们谈的这个题目就是说，因为在英文的这个题目是马克思和就是活的这个马克思主义，为什么今天是对我们来说是更有这个意义？那么我们并不是要做一个就是研究马克思的这个学者，但是我们去发现，就从马克思开始，我们就可以去就分析我们世界究竟是怎么样的这个变化。 那么我们的目的是要就是改变这个社会，改变这个世界，所以首先我们需要就是了解有一个透彻的这个了解。那么而我们这个了解不是从文字上，不是从理论上，而是首先需要从这个行动上。所以我们就是只有在行动里面，我们才可以发展马克思主义。那么他也特别说，我们不是一个马克思主义，我们是有多种的马克思主义。那么他就需要看到在不同的这个时空之下，我们可以怎么去改变这个社会。那么就马克思当时是怎么理解他所在的这个环境和提出他的那种学说的。 所以我们不说真的假的马克思主义，而是我们就是说，我们是怎么看到就是一个怎么样的这个社会的条件，就产生出这种对社会的这个分析，而且从而就是导致一种就是可能的那个发展。所以他就有两个主要的这个结论。 那么一个就是今天我们面对中国和面对就是中国的人民和中国的国家，我们究竟面对的是最重要的还是真实的这种挑战是什么？那么从这儿，从这儿我们就可见就未来可以怎么样。另外第二个就是我们就也就看到就是为什么对于就是无论是南方或者是北方。 就是说发达或者是这个就是全球南方，我们的大多数人来说，为什么我们还是需要就是重新激活这个国际主义？这个国际主义不只是一个道德上的、思想上的，但是是一种组织上的，就是这个一种劳动人民的全球劳动人民的这个国际组织，我们今天是要在这个我们的议程里面提出来。 那么，他说他就是觉得这个我在这个资本主义这个社会，其实我们看它只不过是可能在有些地方一两百年的历史，最多是几百年的历史，但是在中国和埃及这么悠久的历史的国家来说，这个只不过是一个就是历史上的一个小括号。所以我们首先要看一下，就是我们要澄清一些基本的概念。那么。 他一生就读过四次，就通读了马克思的所有的这个著作，就是从他20岁到他80岁啊，四次，每次刚好也都是这个世界很大的这个动荡、很大的变化的时期。他就重读马克思主义，从中也就得到很多的心得。所以他就觉得，第一，我们要很重要的需要区分这个在资本主义的危机。 和在危机中的资本主义，很多人会谈到，就是我们要解决这个危机，但是他觉得不只是这个解决危机，而是我们要离开。 我们要想出怎么离开这个资本主义。那么资本主义已经进入一个就是艾明教授说的叫衰老的那个就是这个阶段。但是它不什么是为什么是衰老？因为它不再有一个进步的意义。但资本主义它的这个指数的增长，它就像癌症一样，它就已经到了一个就是它的这个极限了。但并不是说它作为一个衰老的资本主义，它就会自然死去，因为它就会更加凶猛的要挣扎的，才有把其他的都要毁灭。那么在马克思的这个第二卷里面，他就会谈到整个就是那个制度的它的再生产，这就是每年可能是3%的这个进展。那么当时有很多的就是跟劳动分工的相关的这种条件，是社会劳动的这种生产。那么有人就觉得资本主义可以一直运作下去，那么而且就是因此就给予这个资本主义一种合法性。但是这些都是粗俗的这个经济学他说的，但是他并不能够把它证明。那么资本主义把所有资源都变成商品，把劳动力也都变为商品。那么一般化的这个市场，它会寻找它的平衡，它会所谓的自我的这个调整。但是我们就看到，其实在马克思之前或者之后，基本上是没有任何的这个经济学家可以证明资本主义有这个能力。他们貌似说了很多的重要的话，像很多诺贝尔的得奖者，他们说了，但是其实他们不能证明。但是艾明教授就觉得马克思在他的第二卷的这个资本论里面就证明了这个基本的矛盾。最主要的就是他是不断的要把这个最低工资把工资要压到最低，把利润就放到最大。那么这个就是让这个资本主义最根本上他没办法平衡，没办法就是持续。那么也他也举到就是在1848年，当马克思还是很年轻的时候，他写的这些他写这些文章的时候，那么资本主义当时只是在一个很小的范围好像是存在，包括在英国或者是小部分的法国、比利时等等。但是马克思当时已经能够预测到，就通过他的分析预测到整个就是这个社会的这个未来会是怎么样的。他会看到就是资本主义会征服不仅是整个欧洲，也在几十年之内会征服全世界。那么但是到了顶点的时候，他就无法再持续，他就必须有一个更高级的这个制度取代他。那么我们就看到就有半殖民地的战争，第一次的大战。那么中国当然也就对此特别有体会。那么衰老的那个资本主义，他就是它的整个收入分配的这个差距不可以由制度自己来处理，所以资本主义的危机就是我们看到就是历史上有两次主要的长时期的这个危机，第一次是从19世纪末开始，第二次是从1973年开始到今天还持续着。那么资本主义它的就是怎么就是回应，怎么面对解决它的这种危机呢？那第一，它就走向这个垄断资本主义，它加强了它的经济、政治、文化上的霸权。第二，它加强这个全球化，尽管全球化是在没有资本主义之前已经有了，但是现代的资本现代的这个全球化，主要的就是就是主导的这个帝国主义。那么第三是金融化，它就让这个剩余的利润不再投入的生产，就是所以就从1960年苏锡金才谈到就是资本主义最进入它的衰老期、腐朽期。那么就当然也就一种回应，就是包括列宁或者是毛泽东，他们不仅当时学者，他们也都领导了一个革命，尝试就是跳出这种危机。那么这个衰老的资本主义它并不是说它衰老了它自然会死亡，它是更加凶猛的。所以我们看到它并不会给我们更多的民主，而是我们面对的有是战争和反革命。但是同时我们也就是希望有我们的有些抵抗和一些革命的进展。那么主流他就会不看这些，但是对历史事件，但是对我们来说是非常重要的历史事件。它包括了第一次大战， 就是一二九年的那个危机纳粹就日本的侵略西班牙内战二次大战苏联的红军战胜了这个希特拉中国的革命万隆会议亚非拉的这些各国的独立这些都是对我们来说是很巨大的一些历史的变迁那么在好有些是好的例如说是一些革命或者民族独立但是也有一些非常坏的包括当然就纳粹等等但是这些事件都改变了世界就是说我们在过去的百年看到这种那么第二个长危机就是从1973年开始的它的危机这个特点在于这垄断资本主义它要回应对应这些危机那有三个特点第一它加强了这个垄断资本的力量就是它有一个质变那么它就是会它就尝试去控制所有的这个经济的活动那么所有其他的这个经济部门都等于被承包了就当上这个承包商为它服务举个例子农民他在上游有这个贷款的问题下游就是有这个产品的销售所以市场他并不能够以所谓的市场的真正的价格来出售他的东西而是垄断资本会就是虚假的就是搞了一个价格出来那么有很多详细的研究这里就不谈了就法国意大利的很多经济学家都研究了就是这个农民他举个例子农民面对的时候他们受到怎么样的盘剥那么第二个是加强垄断资本要加强这个全球化就所谓的这个新自由主义它当然包括了就是IMF 就是世界银行或者是欧盟他们给出一些很苛刻的这个条件那么就我们就看到就是1820年的时候现在我们像1820年的时候一样当时的英国的资产阶级就认为工人完全没有权利他们就可以资本家可以认作王位那么第三个特点就是金融化它不断的这个发展那么三个寡头就是美欧日他们就我们就看到它的这种发展就是在中国我们看到就没有那么不平衡但是也它也都存在举个例子就是1913年的时候这个金融的部门它就占这个GDP 是3%1945年之后是占的是30%但是在过去的30-40年以内就特别快的这个就是而且占的这个比例特别大所以我们就看到这些就是这种衰老的这种各种的增长那么我们看到就是在南方好像是在例如说在中国有很高的这个增长那么但是我们也就看到好像这个西方资本主义的危机就它的重心转到东亚转到中国那么就是好像他们的就是说不是它的危机它是它的高增长好像已经就这个重心转到这个中国包括印度巴西这个好像是事实但是我们怎么理解这种发展就是说旧的西方帝国主义它尝试控制全球它是用暴力的手段那么今天其实它也都是类似的也都是这样在西欧在美国等等地方资产阶级的这个民主它就越来越被削弱那么集权的这个社会它就是俘虏了我们的政治它包括了左右的这个政党都被它俘虏那么以前1945年的时候我们有真正的一些社会民主党它当时也都会引入很多对工人阶级的这种社会福利但是今天的社会民主党都是所谓的社会自由主义这其实我们不可能看到有自由主义的时候它也可以照顾社会的利益就说本身这个就是一个矛盾的词它就让这个整个政治的民主失去它的合法性所以尽管我们有多党制有投票但是我投票之后第二天国会依然要服从这个市场服从于这个垄断的资本主义所以为什么我们有些人就说为什么我们还需要这么多的经济学家他们说的其实都是相同的话他们就都是被俘虏的那么另外我们看到这个传媒和这个文化也都同样的是被俘虏的那么在文化上我们大部分不再是主动的思考而是我们变成是很被动的围观者 那么把这个阿明教授就叫它做软性的集权主义。那么我们都会乖乖的工作，我们接受这个现实。但是当我们开始不服的时候，当我们开始抵抗的时候，那么这个软性的集权主义就会变成这个硬性的，那就会动用这个警察和军队。所以最好的可能性就是说，我们不只是知识分子，而是更多的人可以对这个现实有一个穿透性的分析，可以走出这个资本主义。尽管这个路很长，我们不是解决它的危机，而是解决资本主义本身。那么另外一个我们看到现在新的特点就是说帝国主义它并不新鲜，但是它已经有一个质的变化。以前英美日法的帝国主义他们之间有这个矛盾，所以我们才看到以前有这么多的这个战争。现在我们是有一种叫collective imperialism， 就是一个集体的帝国主义，或者叫一个帝国主义集体。那么它就是我们怎么可以证明它是一个集体呢？我们只要看它的就做一个军事联盟，以美国为主的，所以它的其他的都是从属它的这个同盟。那么因为为什么他们需要这个集体呢？因为他们需要更多的就控制这个社会的控制这个社会。那么很多的天真的中国人，他就是中国人阿明教授说好像挺天真的，那么就未必看到现在这个情况。那么就没有特别看到怎么就集体这个帝国主义集体它现在怎么共同的就对付我们。那么我们就在亚非拉，我们占的就是人口的就是超过85%，可能它大概到90%，但是我们无足轻重，因为我们继续被控制。那么很多就是很多中国人也就会以为我们就是有这个高的经济的增长，我们是一个经济大国，我们有一个悠久的这个历史，所以我们就可以就是跟和谐的发展。但是阿明教授说，你们是不会给他们所接受的，他不会让你发展，就前面等着我们的是一个灾难和战争。所以他做了两个结论，第一个就是究竟我们面对的是怎么样的这个挑战。因为这个三个寡头啊，就美日欧，他们不会接受中国是一个繁荣的中国，甚至他们不会接受一个资本主义的中国。就是我们可以看到就是俄国的这个经验，当时叶利钦他以为扔掉了社会主义，就以西方的资本主义为一个模范的话，他就会被全盘的就被西方所接受。那么所以他当时他们就是完全投降于这个资本主义的规则，就当时最多最后后来西方还是把它摧毁，所以它只能变成一个提供原料的这个从属国。那么如果我们吸收俄国的这个历史教训，我们就看到就是美国不会接受中国的成功，所以大家别天真。那么我们就是面对这个威胁，现在中国还是面对这个威胁，包括了美国它现在针对北朝鲜和伊朗，那么一个在中国的东边，一个在中国的西边，所以名义上是在把这两个国家要非核化，但是而且以这个为借口，可能要对他们做一个军事的就是攻击。但是这个其实他们攻击的主要的对象还是中国。那么另外就是也有他们有些计划要把中国分裂。例如说把西藏啊、新疆啊等分裂出去，那么也有一些就是美国的所谓的这个高度秘密的文件，其实都是已经公开了，大家可以看到，包括了美国总统克林顿曾经签署了一个文件，就是说就是背书了，就是说如果对中国进行这个核攻击的话，就可以灭掉61的中国人，所以这些大家都可以去查，就是这些公开的资料存在。所以可以怎么办？这第一，我们需要有这个穿透性的这个明确的这个理解分析对这个世界的现状。那么中国现在进入了一个就以前是就是就做这个贸易的全球化，我们就在出口方面很进取，但是现在我们进入了这个资本的这个在投资，开始邀请这个外资进入。那么就而且中国的资本也出口就跑到外面，就是买这些资产。 那么到目前为止我们还是有很多的这个规定，很多限制这个外资在中国的活动，例如说有很多监管，那么大家应该好好的去研究这种监管是有什么这个条文，而且是有什么效用。但是而且中国到现在为止还没有进入这个金融的现代化，银行还是国有的，人民币的汇率还是由政府决定，不是由市场来决定。因此不参与这个金融的这个全球化是对中国非常有利的。那么我们举个例子，以中国和印度做一个比较的话，中国的这个购买力它是全球这个GDP 的18%，如果你用美元来算的话它占16%，就是说也差不多。但是如果是印度的话，它基本上已经50%到100%的这个全球化了，金融化了，所以它的购买力是全球 GDP 的8%，但是用美元来算的话它低于2%。那就是说垄断的资本已经把这个印度变成它的承包商，所以这个利润全都跑出去了。所以今天就是在中国你们手上有这个枪，你不参与这个金融的这个全球化，但是为什么你们要把这个枪交给敌人，明天就让敌人来对着你开枪？所以你们应该把这个枪留在自己手上。第二，中国是不是是资本主义还是社会主义？阿明教授觉得就不是这样问的。第一，中国好像两样都不是，既不是社会主义也不是资本主义。资本主义一个很重要的就是它的土地是私有化的，到目前为止中国的这个农村还是这个地还是有的，这个国有的财产由这个乡村的社区来管理，基本上还是能够比较平等的这个利用。那么历史上中国是有这个农民和城市工人和中间阶级的一种联盟，所以这个是你们的第二把枪。所以不要让这个地农地这个土地变成商品，不要像巴西那样，在中国我们有6%的全球6%的可耕地，就让20%的人可以吃得饱。那最重要的就是土地并不是商品，但是在巴西它的地跟人的比例比中国好17倍，但是它只有就是它，但是它现在只有10%的这个农村人口是非常贫穷，而且3/2的城市人口住在贫民窟。那么中国是穷，但是它的人民并不是有绝对的贫穷。那么巴西是很富的这个资源，但是它是有大规模的这个就人民的这个贫穷。第三点是我们要反对这个三个寡头，就是美日欧。那么但是我们看到现在的反抗是非常零散的，它是就是而且是保卫性的，不是进攻性的。那么我的这个主动性还是在敌人手上，所以我们需要有一个另类的出路，另类的这个自己的计划。历史是很长的，但是这个整个衰退的这个期也是会挺长。那么第二个问题就是我们在这个地方上就有需要更多的就是联系，你不要这么分散零散。那么在全球上我们就是看到马克思他不仅是分析他的这个社会的问题，他还包括参与了第一国际的这个成立。所以我们需要组织，需要在我们共同利益之上来组织。欧洲的工人阶级有第二国际，列宁之后有第三国际，就加入了就阿非拉的这些就是政党。所以我们现在也都需要一种要创造一个国际，有共同的战略，寻找共同的胜利。那么我们不一定要一个大写的这个革命啊，但是我们需要有一个革命性的前进的这个步骤。那么毛泽东是非常务实的，他一个方面最主要的就是说我们很重要的是走向社会主义还是走向这个资本主义。共产主义并不是一个乌托邦，它是人类文明的更高的这个阶段，所以我们要就是以团结取代现在资本主义的最重要的这个原理，就是竞争。那么我们需要有耐心，需要有方向，今天的乌托邦会变成明天的现实。那么这个就是
Thank you.
Thank you.